Hi, and welcome to the Desert Lady Diaries podcast, a weekly conversation with women who found their home in the Mojave Desert. I'm Dawn Davis, and this is episode number 39. If you're a first-time listener, welcome. And if you're a returning listener, thank you so much for coming back. If you're looking for more information about the podcast, past guests, or want to catch up on previous episodes, or just want to drop me a line, it's all at the website desertladydiaries.com. We're on Facebook and Instagram at Desert Lady Diaries and on Twitter as Desert Lady Diary. Christina Sanchez joins us today to talk about rock climbing, desert dating, and her plant medicine business, Every Leaf Speaks. Today, my guest is Christina Sanchez. She's the owner and herbalist of Every Leaf Speaks. She's a wild crafter, hairstylist, and has many passions, but plant medicine is one of them. She has studied herbalism at the Gaia School of Healing and Earth Education and is now in her second year of studies at Green Wisdom Herbal Studies. Rooted in the wise Womban tradition, creating herbal remedies made with the medicinal native plants of the Mojave Desert that she ethically forages to blessing herbs. She also does herbal consultations and recently began teaching classes on medicine making. Welcome to the podcast.
Thank you.
What was your first experience in the desert?
My first experience in the desert was coming out here with some friends to meet a friend for New Year's Eve at Pappy and Harriet.
Oh, fun.
I came out and I got to meet a local musician and we became good friends, and he kind of introduced me to a lot of the area, the secrets. Like, he took me to Gars for the first time. I hadn't even been to the national park ever, like to this one. So he took me to the national park and he kind of showed me and introduced me to some folks. And I had friends that have moved out here. Mm-hmm. So it was more of, I knew people and I was actually doing things. I was introduced to a lot of different musicians, artists, creative folks. So it was my first introduction to the actual desert. Mm-hmm. Was coming out on New Year's Eve and meeting a bunch of awesome people.
That's great. Yeah. So from that to actually moving and living here, how did that transition happen?
Well, I started coming more frequently out to the desert. I kind of got hooked because it was so beautiful. I'm not from Orange County, but I lived there for many years because that's mm-hmm. where my other business, I'm a hairdresser, so that's where my clients were established. I'd come out here just for the basis of like getting away from the city, mm-hmm. getting away from that stressful environment. Right. And I began to fall in love, and then I saw my friends, John and Sierra, how they had made this beautiful nest. And one day she had helped me. We were going around looking for places and she found this place that was next to hers that was available. And my friend Matt from the Blank Tapes, we both moved out here together and we like moved out as like roommates. So mm-hmm. that's how we started. It was more like I wanted to be out here more often. And I was doing the, you know, dual residency thing up until last year. So for 3 years, I was doing this here for 3 to 4 days in the desert and spending the rest of my time working. And then I slowly started to cut my schedule down because I wanted to somehow establish clientele here and make myself rooted into the community. So I was tired of the two of everything, that the all of the material. Like, I had 2 living room sets, 2 bedroom sets.
Oh my gosh.
I wanted to simplify my life, and I felt like I was being owned by my material objects. So I started last February, I had a month-long estate sale and got rid of as much as I could, found a different place to move out to, mm-hmm. and made this my permanent residence. So I'm here now. It's been a year.
Right. When you first came out, you said you met friends at Pappy and Harriet's, and then you met someone who kind of took you around and introduced you to the place. Usually I ask, how did you get into the community here? But it sounds like, based on what I'm hearing, you were here a couple of days a week, so that gave you an opportunity to be out and meet people. So what sort of activities and events did you participate in that then had you meeting your community, if you will?
Well, I got to meet Cody and Sarah from Totally Blown, and they used to have that little alley next to...
Oh, Sun Alley?
Sun Alley.
Okay.
So Sierra got a little Ramble on Vintage. She had like a little shop that she set up, and then Cody and Sarah, that's where they do a lot of their dye work and their work for their clothing line at that time. They used to have jam sessions in that area. There was a stage back there, so there would be jam sessions. So then, you know, I got involved with the music community here, but more of the creative artist type. And then as the time has gone on, I developed an interest in rock climbing.
Oh.
So I started to meet climbers. I dated a climber. He wasn't from here, but we met here.
Right.
You know, because he was here for the season. Then I got to meet other climbers of the community, like mm-hmm. local legends. My neighbor was one. And then I kind of became in that community. That's where I found myself, you know, mm-hmm. more with the community, because it's, right. I definitely have a passion for rock climbing. It's been medicine for me, and it's been hard for me, you know, it's been.
Well, it's to challenge yourself sometimes with something is important.
It's super important, mm-hmm. but it's like, I've got to meet other climbers through that. So I feel like there is a community with the climbing community in Joshua Tree, just mm-hmm. in the high desert's real strong. And yeah. so it's been a nice network where I've been able to meet other women, other guys that are climbers, mm-hmm. and Todd Gordon has been one of my mentors, Frank Bentwood, Kelly Vaught. I've climbed with some amazing people who have really helped push me mm. and taught me a lot. So
well, and I wasn't really aware until very recently that there was this kind of old, especially an old-timey climbing oh, yeah. community, like from way back in, like, the people are going to say way back in the late 60s.
In the 60s,
and
yeah.
the early 70s. And it wasn't until, I think it's Kim Stringfellow is doing the, it's a project she's doing called the Mojave Project. And one of the articles that was written for that project was all about and talked with some of those climbers.
Yeah.
So that's an interesting thing that I've learned. That's really awesome that you got into that yeah. community and learned so much.
Yeah. I'm still learning. I'm still growing. I've only been climbing on a more consistent basis a little over a year and a half. I find climbing partners that I can trust that are safe, and I climb with a tight knit group here mm-hmm. in the high desert. And it's taken me to places where I'm traveling, climbed a mountain, you know, I've accomplished big goals I've had.
Yeah.
So it's really branching out and meeting other folks in different mm-hmm. areas.
Right.
So the climbing community is tight knit. It's almost like vein system, because everybody knows people. Like, people know each other in Moab that live here. People know each other in Bishop. So I'm connected. If I want to climb in those areas, I can yeah. find somebody to climb with.
Tell me what was it that spurred you to do it the first time, and then what hooked you?
Okay, so I am obsessed with documentaries on nature, you know? Mm-hmm. So I've always had an interest in K2 and Mount Everest, Denali. Mm-hmm. These are things that they're not rock climbing per se, it's more mountaineering. And I've been so amazed by the history and even like the death that is involved. So I've been so interested in that. And I went backpacking for the first time by myself on the John Muir Trail, like I've done little trips, but it was my first time long distance backpacking. I met a climber who we trekked together for a few days, and he was a guide in the Swiss Alps.
Wow.
And so he started spotting when we're trekking together, he would point out different features in rocks, and he was telling me different things. And I told him how I was interested in, you know, I want to do Everest if I ever have $60,000 to get a guide service. So that's where I had the introduction, and his name is Rex, and we're good friends till this day. And Rex really encouraged me to climb. I had other folks that wanted me to climb with them. It was more men trying to hit on me that would see me on Instagram, you know, creeps. And so they would invite me to go climbing with them. And I never, at that point, was still too scared to take that plunge. And then I ended up meeting this guy who I ended up dating later. And he took me to climb the headstone in Josh in Ryan Campground. I couldn't get past the second bolt because I had a fear of heights.
What's a bolt?
It's on the rock where they actually put a bolt in so you could click in your quick draw in. So
okay.
it's a place that, you know,
for people
safety.
Listening who have no idea.
Yeah, so, you know, it's just a bolt on the rock. And sometimes when you're in Josh and if you're in the park and you could see kind of shiny reflective things, that's the bolts.
Okay.
So those are bolted routes. And then there's trad climbing, which I prefer trad than bolted.
And what is trad?
Trad is when you're placing gear, you're placing like camelots into cracks and systems of the rock to get up to the top.
Okay, all right. Sorry to get off track.
It's okay, it's fine. But it was a lot of fun doing that. And then we ended up dating. And he would take me out all the time. And it took a lot for me to get over the fear of heights and fear of exposure. And it's been something that has been like real medicine. Like, I get emotional about it.
Yeah.
But it's been healing mm-hmm. in many ways.
Yeah.
So I did that. And then I've just been climbing ever since, finding partners. Todd Gordon has been somebody that's mm-hmm. mentored me.
Let's talk about that a little bit, because it's something that I don't think we talk about very often on the podcast, which is the dating situation.
Mm-hmm.
What's your experience been? And whatever you want to share is fine. As a education for maybe either a woman who's thinking of moving to the desert on her own, or for some that are new here.
Yeah.
With that in mind.
Yeah. Well, I would definitely say don't have your eyes closed. Have your eyes open. Because I am such a loving, open person that I see the good in people. And I feel like my radar for, I don't know, can I say douchebags?
Sure.
My douchebag radar wasn't up to par. Like, I always want to see the good in people. But then there's also the people here that present themselves as light, present themselves as loving, good people. Mm. Then you're going to get the ones that are going to be portraying themselves as, I want to help you. I want to be your friend. If you're in need, I will be
right there for
you. I'll be right there for you. But it comes at a cost. So you have to stand your ground. It's kind of unfortunate to be somebody that you have to be guarded all the time, but we need to guard ourselves. Being a single woman in the desert, you're going to get hit on by men who you have zero in common with, but they're going to not see that. They're going to see, if you're not firm with them, they're going to see that there's maybe
an opening.
You know, maybe they can break you into liking them. Mm. And then there's the ones that hide their true selves, like psychopaths. Sociopaths. Mm. There's the ones that present themselves as being good-natured people, you know, part of the community. But then there's this whole dark, like, I'm going to expose it. I didn't realize what a big scene cocaine is here. I'm serious.
I didn't either
until recently. I am somebody that is connected with Gaia. I love the plants. I don't even take aspirin. I can't see myself putting something like that, and then living that kind of lifestyle where it's dark, and dark breeds upon dark. Mm-hmm. So it's like, I can't deal with that kind of crap. And if they think I'm a prude, I'm not. It's just, I want to keep myself in places of good light. And I just feel like you have to ask around. So,
well, and yeah, for me, it's the way I view altering your state is that, and especially for being my age, I'm at the point where I look and see I've got a lot more behind me than I have ahead of me. And what's ahead of me, I don't want to live in an altered state because I don't have much time left. So why would I put myself in those places?
Exactly.
I mean, there's a place for things like, say, ayahuasca or something like that, that you may use to open yourself up as medicine to just see more.
And heal. And a lot of that is healing medicine.
Exactly.
I had friends that let me know what was going on, and I got to see it at first hand, and it really bummed me out because I really wanted to see the best in this person. And so I'm saddened but I'm not saddened. I am so grateful that things have happened that have slapped me around into waking up, because my life is not, I don't have space for negativity or darkness. Mm-mm. In it. And I don't want anybody near me that's going to be putting crap up their nose or smoking crap that they, you know, like I'm down with like cannabis. It's healing. It's medicine. Mm-hmm. But when you abuse cannabis, then I'm just like.
Right. When you can't be present, because being present is living your life.
Yeah.
And not being present is not living your life. And it's just letting the days go by. So, I mean, I guess that's my kind of soapbox on that.
No, it's just been really educating to me. This last experience, I've now, if a man is interested in me, I have a buddy. I have a couple buddies. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, okay, give me the beta on this person. Mm-hmm. What is this person like? Because I don't want to even open the door to possibility without knowing what this person's like.
Right, because it can get too far.
It could get too far, and then feelings get involved, and people get crushed.
Right,
and
exactly.
I don't want any of that.
How has the desert played a role in bringing that all to the fore, to be okay with putting up a little bit of a shield, if you will, balanced with kind of being open to possibility? Or healing, for that matter.
Yeah. Well, the desert has definitely been medicine for me. Like I said, I came where my business, I was behind the computer blogging, working on my websites. That I used to design jewelry at one point. So I had that going too. And I felt like I never had space for me. So leaving that behind and coming to the desert, I got to discover nature. You don't see the sunsets like this in the city. You don't see the stars. You don't see the moon, the way it rises. So it's been healing for me, and it's also been very medicinal for me. And when I began to develop an interest in plant medicine and develop an interest in learning more about the plants here native to where we live, the plants have really helped me heal. So it's not only like the desert, it's also the medicine of the plants and learning how to communicate with the plants and the plant spirit has helped me. And there's been like creosote bush is one of my biggest allies. She's taught me how to be strong. She's taught me how to be resilient. And that's what you need in this desert, because
it's harsh.
It's harsh. And if we don't establish boundaries and honor our boundaries, we're just going to get sucked up. So exactly. For me, it's been more so getting out in nature, climbing, working with the plants, wildcrafting, self-learning these plants, connecting with other botanists and herbalists, some herbalists. I've connected more with botanists that I've met through the park that have also helped me, and education as well, going to school, but definitely getting out in nature by myself, not necessarily with friends, going in groups, hiking alone and connecting with the land has really helped me love myself. But I still, for a long time, I didn't know about that boundary. I mean, until recently, I was just like, stop.
Well, and that's good. Now you're protecting yourself.
We have to.
Again, balanced with an openness to possibility. Tell me about wildcrafting.
Okay. Well, see, I'm big on ethical wildcrafting. I'm not somebody that goes into places where you're not supposed to be wildcrafting. I'm definitely looking into areas that I can. And the way I was taught is you leave the plant like looking as though you've never touched it. And also on a more spiritual side of it is connecting with the plant itself. So I don't just go and rape and pillage a plant. I actually sit there, connect, and almost like a little meditation with the plant and ask for permission. And I always offer a gift, may that be water or blessing herbs that I keep in a little, like this is kind of an example. And I always give them a little bit of plant. Some folks traditionally have offered tobacco.
Right, I don't that's have, the one I know of, yeah.
Yeah, I don't have a connection. I don't like cigarettes. I'm not a tobacco person, but I do connect with different plants, and so that's what I offer them. And I always look for plants that are medicinal, plants that will help me. I have asthma, and so I've really studied the plants that are here in the Mojave that will help strengthen our lungs and build our immunity. So that's the plants that I look for. And also plants that are also great for arthritis. My mother has rheumatoid arthritis. So I did a lot of studies to learn what plants are local that I can use to create. I have a product called Warming Vibes that's great for arthritis pain. That has pinyon pine resin. It's really great because I've learned how to create medicine with these plants by studying them. I save plants for tea form. I make oils out of them. I make tinctures. I make oxymils with them. So I get real creative with this, the medicine that I'm harvesting.
That's awesome. And you just recently did a workshop creating fire cider.
The traditional Rosemary Gladstar, she is the herbalist that started. She came up with this folk remedy eons ago, and I just took it for a spin. I love fire cider. It's building to the immune system, the respiratory, digestive, everything. It's so building during cold and flu time season. So I wanted to incorporate native plants, so I foraged sagebrush, pinyon pine. My friends that live up here, I needed rosemary, so they had rosemary.
I saw you post on Facebook, like, I'm looking for some unprocessed rosemary.
I was like, I don't want anything that's been sprayed with pesticides. And I had such a big response. So now I saved, how you could save the links or whatever. So I saved those. So when I need more rosemary, I can approach those people.
That's great.
We also had yerba santa. And what else did we incorporate? Desert globe mallow was another one. So I did a lot of foraging for the plants for the class, as well as in addition using the basis of the traditional formula, which is, have you ever had fire cider?
No.
No? It's, I should brought some. I'll bring some. I'm actually making some more. But it has horseradish, jalapenos, habaneros. Think of any spicy, you know, anything that's going to clear you up. That's what's in there. Onions, garlic. It's delicious. And you add apple cider vinegar and honey.
Oh, I was just going to say, it's hot. What else is
it? It's spicy, yeah. So the honey will sweeten it.
Yeah.
Somebody in the class, or she wasn't a part of the class, she was the marketing director of Cactus Smart. That's where we had the class. She's vegan, so she was going to add in agave to sweeten it up a little bit. But honey has a lot of medicinal properties as well.
That's especially if it's locally.
Local honey, So I get my honey from Steve in Pioneer Town. That's where I get all my honey for the medicine that I make. So I encourage using local honey.
Right, because it has something to do with like the local plants and pollen and air, and it really helps your body kind of I don't want to say fight off. I don't think that's the right word, but eliminate like an allergy.
Allergies, thing. Yes.
Right. If you use stuff that's local to you.
And local within 100 miles is what is considered to be local. And it's so hard. The health food store has some honey that's local that they try to stock their shelves with because it's really great in building during allergy season. Mm-hmm. Another thing that folks don't know, that stinging nettle is another ally for allergy season or just allergies. We have a cat where I live, and I love him, but sometimes
Aloysius,
you know him.
I do.
Yeah, he's so sweet, and sometimes I get a little itchy eyes, so I made a nettle oxymel, and I take that, or nettle tincture, or make nettle tea for that purpose. And also yerba santa is a local ally that will also help for allergies as well. Okay. But I found it more effective to work with stinging nettle. Mm.
So when you work with these plants and make these tinctures and stuff like that, what is like the process? So you go forage them and then you bring them back to your kitchen laboratory. And what happens? Do you like boil things or take leaves off twigs? Yeah. I mean, how's that all?
There's different methods. If I'm going to reserve them for oils, for instance, I hang my herbs to dry.
Okay.
You'll get mold. And it'll go bad if you have a moist plant with moisture and you're putting it in oil. But if you want to make a tincture, you can either use dried plant material or fresh plant material. So if I'm making tinctures, if I'm going to make an oxymel, if I'm going to use an alcohol base, or if I'm going to use a menstruum using like apple cider vinegar, then I can use fresh or I use dry. Okay. So a lot of these times I will reserve some so I could have for tea or make infusions with. Like this is a mullein. Mullein's not native to us, but this is a mullein nourishing herbal infusion that I've been working with because I've been having a little tight chest with my asthma lately. Mullein is an ally for the lungs and so is yerba santa. So I will reserve a bunch and break them up and chop them up and use it for future uses of teas. If I want to use oils, tinctures, I never forage anything just to grab it. I always have some type of purpose and plan in mind. Chris has been, it's like a little kitchen witch, like kitchen for the witch and Aloysius loves plants. He'll jump on the counter and he'll watch me process them. Mm-hmm. So a lot of times I dry my herbs, powder them up and put them in honey.
So when you powder them up, how does that happen? What do you mean?
I put it in my Ninja, blend it up. So yeah. I have this, I should have brought it. I was dashing out of the house.
It's okay.
I have an electuary that is the essence of the desert. And so I have pinyon, yerba santa, desert globe mallow. What else?
I just like the sound of
white sage.
Yeah, desert globe mallow.
Desert globe mallow. It's beautiful. And then Nicole from Cactus March, she lets me go and harvest some of her white sage. Because white sage is a plant that is also endangered. It's on the to watch list on United Plant. Yeah, so I don't really support buying. A lot of times when you go to the health food stores or you're ordering white sage, if they don't say the source, it's usually wildcrafted. And because it's a plant that is in threat, one of the plants that is in threat, I try to stay away from it. You know, I only harvest locally from friends' gardens or, you know, I want to grow my own eventually. I just have I'm really bad at gardening.
Yeah,
I just have challenges.
I don't have any plants. I buy, you know, flowers at the farmer's market and put them in a vase. I call it the black thumb.
The black thumb.
I even had cactuses back east because that's how ingrained I think the desert was in me, that even every place I've ever lived, I've decorated as if I was living in the Southwest.
Yeah.
So I think something in me knew I would be here before I did. But I even had cactuses back east, that those little ones you buy, you know, at the supermarket, and I couldn't even keep those alive.
See, I'm good with succulents and I'm good with cactus. But when it comes to growing white sage, I was gifted black sage once and it died. I get really bummed out. Yeah. And I really want my dreams to have a medicinal garden so I can.
Well, this is a new challenge for you then.
It is. Yeah.
It's a new challenge.
Yes.
You sent me a little poem. Mm-hmm. And I would love for you to read it.
Okay. This is a poem by Susan Weed.
Tell us about her.
Susan Weed is an herbalist from the Catskills, and she's been practicing herbalism for over 50 years. I came across her podcast years ago, and just from wanting to learn about plants, and I think I like typed in something like herbalism or plant medicine, and she popped up. So she's coined the wise woman tradition, a tradition of healing, and a tradition of healing where we don't look at the body as We're dirty, we're filthy, we need to cleanse ourselves, purge ourselves, puke, get rid of. It's about looking at ourselves as a whole and nourishing ourselves in wholeness and not saying, I have a bad heart. No, my heart is good. I just need to nourish it. So it's a different way of thinking. And that's what got me into wanting to study the wise woman tradition when I first went to school the first time. And this is a poem that I had come across of hers like a long time ago. And it's somebody, like, she's been somebody that's been a green mentor, even though I've never met her. She's somebody that I appreciate what she's doing for the community and the way that she educates people and the way she looks at the body. I love it. And especially as, you know, as being a woman, is she's empowering. So you want me to read this?
I would love that.
All right. I see the wise woman. From her shoulders, a mantle of power flows. I see the wise woman at her loom. Every thread is different, each perfect and splendid. Alive with sound and color. I see the wise woman. She is old and black and walks with the aid of a beautifully carved stick. She speaks in song, in story, and dance. She lives in every herb. I see the wise woman, and she sees me. She winks at me and spreads her arms. These are the ways of our grandmothers, the ancient ones. Every pain, every plant, every problem is cherished. Night is loved for darkness, day for light. Uniqueness is our treasure, not normalcy. These are the ways of our grandmothers, the ancient ones. Receive abundance with compassion, knowing you will be food for others. Know that dying is a portal just as birth is. Celebrate all comings and goings. They are the turnings of the spiral. These are the ways of our grandmothers, the ancient ones. The joy of life is a giveaway. You are the center of your universe. You are the axis, life matrix, the still point in every moving thing. The designs of the universe radiate through you. You are a goddess, unique and whole. I see the wise woman, and she sees me. She smiles from shrines in thousands of places. She is buried in the ground of every country. She flows in every river and pulses in every ocean. The wise woman's robe flows down your back, centering you in the ever-changing, ever-spiraling mystery. Everywhere I look, the wise woman looks back, and she smiles.
I love that.
Me too.
And I think it's a perfect way to end this podcast, and it was a perfect thing for Desert Lady Diaries.
Yes.
So thank you very much for being here. I appreciate that. And if you're interested in hearing more about Every Leaf Speaks, we'll have some links on the blog page so you can check out Christina's work and communicate that way.
Yeah. And I'll be teaching a lot more classes and a lot of more plant IDs and so forth coming up very soon.
Excellent.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dawn, for having me.
Thanks so much for listening to the Desert Lady Diaries podcast. I want you to know how much I appreciate you taking the time to tune in. If you heard something that inspired or enlightened you, I'd love to hear about it. Send an email to desertladydiaries@gmail.com or start a discussion with other listeners at the Desert Lady Diaries Facebook page. And a big shout out to Thoughtful Misfit, Nancy Griss, Capri Pinto, and Sarah Foster for reaching out and letting me know how valuable you're finding the podcast. I really appreciate hearing from you guys. So thanks so much for doing that. Next week, we go back to 29 Palms to talk with Liz Meyer, whose parents, Roy and Ada Hatch, were among some of the first pioneer homesteaders in the 1930s in 29 Palms. Thanks so much for listening.